Hey, my friends, it's Tom with Watchman River. Thanks for joining me today. It's another good day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. How are you guys today? I hope you're well. They're saying that Iran may attack Israel within, the report said, 24 to 48 hours. I'm saying 36 hours because that report was at least 12 hours ago. Will that happen? I don't know. We'll talk about that. And what else? I want to talk about, I got so much to cover today, and I feel like I don't have enough time, so I should probably get busy. So yesterday, I was trying to say, kind of funny, I was trying to say a Jan Markell quote that she always says, that it looks like everything's falling apart, but it's actually falling into place. And I had a gastular brain moment, is what I called it, instead of using the nastier word. And it was funny because many people told me the right quote because I just couldn't remember it. And I thought about it, and it really reminded me of my youth when my parents hit about 55 years old. All of a sudden, something happened to them, and I couldn't understand it as a young man, because when my mom was 55, I was 25, you know. And all of a sudden, she'd go, Tom, I washed your, I put them in the washing machine. I'm like, what, Mom? What? What is that word? You know, the dungarees things. My jeans? Yeah, your jeans. And then she'd go, oh, she'd get frustrated. I'm like, how can she not remember the word jeans? And then I hit 55. Because I think that's about when it started for me. And I know a lot of you talked about that in the comments too, that you hit a certain age where all of a sudden you get these, I call them gastular brain events, where you just can't remember something simple that you've said a thousand times. And I had one of those moments yesterday. I call it seasoning. That's what I call it. You know, when you get older, I call it seasoning. You know, we're finally seasoned, you know, so we don't have to remember the simple stuff because in all our wisdom, we remember the important stuff. Anyway, that's what I got. Oh, let's go to scripture now, okay? I got some good ones. I want to read some scriptures about eternal life, because these scriptures just excite me as we await our rescue, as we await the pre-tribulation rapture, which I believe we're on the cusp of. And my goodness, all right, I'll get into other stuff later, but there's so much stuff going on that's can be deceptive, and you got to be so careful. And I'm learning more and more with you guys as we move along. You know, not everything's black and white. You got to be so careful. But anyway, let's go to some scriptures about eternal life. Let's go to John chapter 10, verses 28 through 30. And I get, these are the words of Jesus. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Whew, right there. There you go. You belong to Jesus. You trust in his finished work and his atoning blood. He ain't letting you go. 1 John chapter 2, verse 17. And the world is passing away and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. Oh, man, count me among them. I belong to Jesus, and most of you do. And we will abide with him forever because of what he did. It's all him. It's nothing we do. It's all him. Let's go to John 3:16. Everyone knows this, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Oh, amen. Let's go to 1 John chapter 5, verse 13. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Jesus did something amazing for us. He paid for our sins with his blood. And when you put your faith in that blood and you believe in his finished work, he has eternal life for us. That's why I don't worry about all the crazy stuff I see going on in the world, because the one who holds all the keys, the one who died for us, loves us, and he has an incredible future for us. all glory to him. One more. Love these verses. This is Revelation 21, verse 3 and 4. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. How would you like to be a part of that kind of future? That's what we have in Christ Jesus, you guys. That's what we have in Christ Jesus. It's mind-blowing. It really is. Don't get weighted down by the things that are going on in this world. We're in the last days. You know, what did you expect the last days to look like? There's a lot of lies and deception. There's a lot of crazy stuff going on. We're watching it escalate. We're watching things like birth pangs. Sometimes they're crazy, and then all of a sudden there's a lull. Then they get a little crazier, and then there's a lull. Hang on to Jesus in these days. It's the best advice I can give you. You cling to him. You get in that word. You learn about him. You talk to him. You hang out with him. You cling to Jesus, and he'll get you through anything, through anything. He doesn't tell us he'll keep us from trials and tribulation, but he will go through it with you. And it's different. Going through a bad problem is much different when you can hang on to Jesus through it, right? I know a lot of you are saying amen. Give me an amen. Thank you. All right. A lot of you tell me that you talk to me in the video. Like, I'll ask a question and you answer. So once in a while, I'm going to say, give me an amen. Thank you. I know you just said it. All right, let's look at what's going on in the world. So, Israel is preparing. This was all over the place last night and this morning. Israel is preparing for an Iranian attack within 24 to 48 hours. Now, this was at least 12 hours ago that I got this one. So, I'm saying 36 hours. Now, all right, let me read it, and then I'll tell you what I'm thinking about this. Israel is preparing for a direct attack from Iran in the next 24 to 48 hours, a U.S. intelligence source has said. Israel is expecting an attack from Iran on the north or south of the country as early as Friday or Saturday, according to unnamed officials quoted by the Wall Street Journal. An unnamed U.S. official cited intelligence reports indicating an Iran strike possibly on Israeli soil could happen within days. If it does go ahead, Iran's attack on Israel will be the first in a decades-long shadow war between the two countries, which have always been anxious to avoid a direct confrontation. I'm going to tell you what I think is going to happen. I don't think much is going to happen, honestly. I don't think much is going to happen. I think if Israel makes a strike from their direct land, I'm sorry, let me say that again. If Iran makes a direct strike toward Israel from their land, it's going to land like in Iraq, or it's going to land somewhere else. I just don't see it. I think you guys know that I really believe we're in the beginning of the Psalm 83 war and not the Ezekiel 38 war. Even though the players are lining up for Ezekiel 38, that's the amazing thing about prophecy. But Ezekiel 38 war is different. They go in to grab the spoil, grab the booty. Israel is living in peace and no walls, no gates. That's a different war. Psalm 83 war takes care of the inner ring of enemies. Hezbollah, Hamas, Islamic Jihad. You know, it's more of an inner ring of enemies. And I think it prepares the way for the Ezekiel 38 war, which I think happens after the rapture. I think the Psalm 83 war leads into the rapture. That's what I happen to believe on that. And I just think Israel's going to respond probably through their proxies. I don't think it's going to be an overwhelming response. I'd be very surprised. And I don't think Israel's going to go right toward Iran at this time. You know, I think we're close to the rapture. I think a lot of this happens after the rapture. This is from the Times of Israel. Israel on high alert for an Iranian attack, but prepared for any scenario, according to an IDF spokesman. IDF spokesman Admiral Daniel Hagari stresses that there is no change to instructions for civilians as Israel remains on high alert for a potential attack from Iran. We are on a high alert and are highly prepared for various scenarios and we are constantly assessing the situation. We are ready for attack and defense using a variety of capabilities that the IDF has, and has, and also ready with our strategic partners, he said. There you go. This is from Israel Today. Still lots of talk this morning in Israeli mainstream and social media about the looming Iranian attack. It's believed that Iran had planned to already attack, but postponed due to high level of alert of Israelis and American defenses. Iran also reportedly fears a major Israeli and American retaliation if it launches an attack from Iranian soil, and so is more likely to now use Hezbollah to strike Israel. Meanwhile, Israeli municipalities across the country have been instructed by Homefront Command to prepare for a warlike scenario, and the U.S. State Department has warned its employees to avoid traveling outside Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. The U.S. Embassy in Israel has prohibited government employees and their families from traveling personally outside of Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, and Beersheba until further notice amid threats of Iran's response. Also, countries have issued a travel warning for Israel and Iran. The countries that have issued this travel warning are USA, Germany, France, UK, India, and Russia. So everybody knows something's about to happen. They're bracing for this. Like I said, I will see what it is. You know, I don't know. I don't know if it's going to be a powerful one, or I just don't think Iran is going to fully strike Israel from their territory. Iran's been waiting too long for their bomb. And now I'm wondering, this is kind of for humor purposes, but I'm also a little bit serious. You know, we've heard, how many years have we heard, Iran is a month away from the nuclear bomb, and then a year later, Iran is 3 weeks away from a nuclear bomb, and then 2 years later, Iran is a week away from... We've been here. I almost feel like this looming attack on Israel, it's almost like this is the new version of that. You know, they're going to attack within 48 hours. No, they're going to... Well, first they started. They're going to attack by the end of Ramadan. No, they're going to attack within 48 hours. No, they're going to... Can I get an amen? I heard that. Thank you. All right. This is from Newsweek. A warning from Syria as Middle East braces for Iran's revenge on Israel. Syria has issued a new warning to both Israel and the United States. I'm thinking Damascus being a ruinous heap, honestly, as I read this. But Syria has issued a new warning to both Israel and the United States at a time when the Middle East is bracing for Iran's promised retaliation after an alleged Israeli attack on Tehran's embassy complex in Damascus. With the regional tensions already flaring over the ongoing war on the Gaza Strip, the Syrian mission to the United Nations conveyed to Newsweek the country's condemnation in the strongest terms of the Israeli attack that targeted the Iranian consulate building in Damascus. Quote, what the Zionist entity did in targeting the headquarters of a diplomatic mission in a populated area is not surprising, as this entity was built on killing, bloodshed, displacement, and plunder, the mission said. The genocides and it's just like so ridiculous to even read this, but I will. The genocides and massacres that have been conducted by the Israeli entity and that have been continuing in Gaza for more than 6 months are nothing but the clearest evidence of the barbarity of this entity. All right, now talk about October 7th. Because you know what? As of October 6th, it was pretty peaceful in Israel. I just got to remind you of that. Anyway. This is from Insider Paper. China urges the U.S. to play a constructive role in the Middle East. Okay, here we go. China urged the United States to play a constructive role in the Middle East on Friday after its top diplomat Wang Yi, spoke with the U.S. counterpart, Anthony Blinken, over the phone. Blinken used the call to ask Beijing to use its influence to dissuade Iran from striking Israel. The State Department said concerns of retaliation by Tehran have grown after an Israeli strike on April 1st leveled an Iranian diplomatic building in Damascus. So China is saying, hey, play a constructive role. It's just so funny. These leaders of these countries that are, they live one way and they speak another way, right? This is Amir Sarfati said, according to reports this morning, U.S. Defense Secretary Austin was furious with Israeli Defense Minister Gallant that Israel did not inform the United States before the assassination of the Iranian generals in Damascus. On October 11th, Israel planned something big in the north against Hezbollah. The pre-operation update of the Americans led to their pressure on Netanyahu to be against it, a move which eventually led to the abortion of the operation. Most likely this time, whoever carried out this Damascus elimination knew that it would be better for the Americans to know about it after the missiles were launched. I agree. It's better idea. Better idea. Better idea. This one's just, you know, this should be on the front of every newspaper in the world, but it's, you know, never going to hear about it. This is from Ynet. Aid from 600 trucks is stranded inside Gaza, Israel says. Head of COGAT, C-O-G-A-T, tells the UN to do its job after Israel increases delivery of humanitarian aid to the Strip, but it is not collected or distributed. Israel's coordinator for government activities in the territories, Major General Eilon, posted a video showing what he described as the content of 600 trucks worth of humanitarian aid that was delivered from Israel to Gaza through the Kerem Shalom border crossing and had accumulated there over the past week. 600 trucks worth of humanitarian aid. We have increased the hours we operate and have added means to expedite security inspections. Now it is your turn to do your jobs, the official said in a call to the United Nations. Israel is where the bottleneck is. The supplies that are sitting inside Gaza are waiting for the United Nations staff to collect them and distribute their contents. Anyone who tells you that there's a ginormous lack of food in Gaza is not being truthful. They're just letting the aid sit there. It'll rot. You know, it'll rot. Anti-Israel rioters are planning a global economy disruption. First, I heard of this morning. Anti-Israel activists in 30 cities across four continents are threatening to disrupt the global economy on April 15th in an attempt to destroy the Jewish state. The anonymous A15 Action Group announced this week. For 75 years, Israel has operated with impunity. Okay. But the Zionist project must end now, states a video promoting the initiative. The time has come to open up new fronts against the Zionist war machine. You know what? October 6th, Israel was living in peace. Yep. Israel's given them a lot of land. Right now, they're working on a pipeline to give them fresh water. But you don't hear that stuff. You don't hear that. Just the whole world has turned against Israel, as prophesied. We're in the very last days. No surprise. No surprise that the whole world blames them for everything. The sad thing to me is that many Christians have turned on Israel and the Jews. That's what surprises me. Honestly, I did not expect that. But it is a lot. A lot of my viewers have left this channel. You know, it's like, go back to the Bible. You can start in Genesis because it's right there. And go all the way through Revelation, and you will see that Israel and the Jews are God's nation and people. Don't fall for the end times deception, and many of my viewers, former viewers, have fallen for it. And it's sad. It's sad. You're literally falling into the hands of end times deception. Doesn't mean we worship the Israeli government, or we have to worship every move they make, but it's God's people. I'm not turning my back on God's people or his nation. I will bless those that bless thee. I will curse those that curse thee. The words of God, not the words of Tom. Those are the words of God. Okay. This is from Insider Paper. Japan, Philippines, and the United States slams China's dangerous aggressive moves in the South China Sea. They voiced serious concern yesterday, over China's actions in the South China Sea. The nation's leaders said amid a territorial dispute that has become increasingly tense, we express our serious concerns about the People's Republic of China's dangerous and aggressive behavior in the South China Sea, according to a joint statement by the three leaders after a historic meeting in Washington. There's just so much talk of, you know, wars, rumors of wars. Incredible to be living in the last days. Listen to this one. This is like Just pray for the people in Ukraine. This thermal power plant near Kiev was destroyed in a missile attack. And this was from when? Early this morning. The Tripilska thermal power plant, TPP, outside the Ukrainian capital has been completely destroyed in a Russian missile attack. The Interfax Ukraine news agency reported Thursday, citing an official located 45 kilometers south of Kiev. TPP is the largest power generating facility in the Kiev region with an installed capacity of 1,800 MW. On Thursday morning, Russia fired 42 missiles, including 6 aeroballistic missiles and around 40 combat drones, said the Ukrainian Air Force, which shot down 18 missiles and 39 drones. The Ukrainian authorities said that the attack targeted energy infrastructure facilities in 5 regions. Pray for the people in Russia. Pray for the people in Ukraine. It's like, just can't stand that war. Because I've had people who live there literally tell me we're fighting our own people, you know. Just pray for those people. Next, we've got European Union's only nuclear-powered navy is getting ready for war. The European Union's only nuclear-powered navy is getting ready for war as concerns grow that combat is becoming increasingly likely, according to a report. Global tensions have escalated in recent months as the Russia-Ukraine war rages in Eastern Europe and conflict in the Middle East, including the Israel-Hamas war and attacks against the Red Sea. Shipping have sparked concerns about the potential for a wider conflict involving the West. Don't let this stuff worry you. You belong to Jesus. Don't let it worry you. All right. What else? This today is one of the lightest earthquake days I've ever reported on since I've done this. Listen to this. Last 24 hours, 42. That's about normal. Over 4.0. Over 5.0. 1. That makes me go, whoo, what's tomorrow going to be like? Who knows? Because other days where it's been light for a day or two, all of a sudden it gets heavier. So that's one earthquake over 5.0 in the last 24 hours. Pretty wild. All right, this is a story I want to cover. It's all over the internet, but it's all over like Telegram and Twitter. I'm just going to tell you, it's not passing the sniff test for me. Okay, red heifer sacrifice date is confirmed, according to documents submitted officially for an April 22nd sacrifice. This is from Blazing Press. It's the only outlet I found running this. Temple Mount organization submits formal request to conduct red heifer sacrifice at Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem on April 22nd. It showed pictures of the documents. It didn't pass the smell test for me. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm not buying it yet. I'm just going to be honest. The documents looked weird. And I literally thought, if this is on a website and it's all over Telegram and Twitter, or X, whatever they call that, Twitter, tweet or thing. If it's all over the place, why has the Times of Israel or the Jerusalem Post or like none of the Israeli main outlets are going to talk about it? You know, it's just not passing the sniff test for me yet. All right, if that changes, I'll let you know. And I don't know. I'm just Tom. You know, so I may be wrong. I'm the one who said I happen to believe that it's a possibility that they've already sacrificed one of the heifers just to hang on to those ashes in the background. Many people think I'm wrong. It's just an opinion I have. I just think if they've waited 2,000 years for perfect red heifers and they show up, they get 5 of them or 6, whatever it was in the beginning. And then all of a sudden they come of age to be sacrificed. If I'm one of those dudes, I'm grabbing one quietly somehow and I'm getting those ashes. Maybe that's wrong. People tell me, no, there's got to be all these ceremonies. It's got to be from a certain place. I don't know. We'll see. You know, we'll see. I hope we find out in heaven. Wouldn't that be the best place to find out? Okay. Ready or not. Man, how am I doing for time here? Ready or not, AI is in our schools. Dun, dun, dun. It's from Popular Science. Students worldwide are using generative AI tools to write papers and complete assignments. Teachers are using similar tools to grade tests. What exactly is going on here? Where is all this heading? Can education return to a world before artificial intelligence? Around 1 in 5 high school age teens who've heard about ChatGPT say they've already used the tools on classwork, according to a recent Pew Research survey. A separate report from ACT, which creates one of the two most popular standardized exams for college admissions, claims nearly half of high school students have used AI to complete assignments. They're using fake intelligence to further their real intelligence. It's just, it's clown world. That's the only thing that makes sense to me. We're in the last days, and it's clown world. But you know what? If that was clowny, this is clownier. I'll just say that. This is from inc.com. A museum exhibit uses AI tech for a surreal twist that lets visitors talk to the artist. While artificial intelligence has spawned plenty of controversies as it works its way into daily life, the digital resurrection of Salvador Dali shows the technology's educational and entertainment potential. Opening today, a month before what would have been the artist's 120th birthday, the Dali Museum Ask Dali exhibit may be a rare successful marriage of high tech and high art. The installation centers on a physical telephone inspired by Dali's famous lobster telephone sculpture. Picking it up connects museum visitors to an AI chatbot that's powered by several machine learning models, including OpenAI's ChatGPT-4. And when visitors ask a question much that they typed in a prompt, they'll hear an answer spoken, not by the AI, but they're going to hear an answer spoken by Dali's actual voice. He's been dead a long time. And I'm sitting there going like, I stopped pretending when I was a kid. You know, I can't imagine picking up a fake phone and going, you know, hello, Dali. Well, hello, Salvador Dali. Let me ask you a question, Dali. Let me ask you a question. So what's it like to be dead? It's all right. Well, yeah, thanks for talking to me, Dali. I got to go. I'm due back at the planet Earth. Anyway, they're going to... Hold on, where is it? Come on. It's clown world. That is so clowny. It's clownier than clowny in clown world. Do you want to talk to a fake Dali? I don't mean a little Dali. I mean the Salvador Dali. I just don't get it. Maybe if it was a little kids museum or something and they were talking to Ernie and Bert or whatever they're into, I don't know. Boy, am I showing my age. But I'm just not for this AI stuff. I think it's ridiculous. You know, I just do. All right, let's go to a couple testimonies of the day before I run out of time, which I'm almost out of time. Let's do one testimony. Here we go. Claire, I waited patiently. She said, my testimony is Psalm 40. 1 through 17. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. For years, I was bound by fear as a child. All I could do was call to Jesus. He turned to me every time. He lifted me out of a slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my foot on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. My young adult life was full of depressing darkness, but he pulled me out. What he has done in my life is too much to say, but this I know. He knows my name and I hear his voice. It's beautiful. Thank you, Claire. It's beautiful. So a few comments of the day. Janelle, a prayer request for unbelievers. Jesus called me on October 7th, 2022. Oddly, 1 year before the Hamas attacks. He lifted the scales from my eyes, and I invited him into my heart and gave him my life. His grace descended upon me that day from heaven like a flood, and he has healed me of over 26 health issues, mental and physical, so far. He lifted me up out of the darkness, hopelessness, and suffering of this world into his light. I am so grateful and blessed to know God, and I pray for the world that as many as possible may come to know him as I now do. Will you pray the same? Let us pray for all in the Middle East to come to know that he is the Lord their God. May the whole world come to know who the light of the world really is. He is our only hope and peace, for peace and healing in this world. Amen. All glory to Jesus. All glory to Jesus. Thank you, Janelle. Once was lost. I have such peace and trust in Jesus. The more you trust in him, the more your fear and worries melt away. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for sharing that. One saved chick. Since being saved in 2006, I've become a much more emotional person. But lately, anyone else feel like they cry constantly? I see a pretty sunrise, I'm bawling. Listening to worship music, I'm sobbing. Hearing Tom share testimonies in the gospel, tears. It's like my spirit is supercharged right now and all my senses feel his presence. So ready to go home. Love you all. Yeah, I'm like that too. I cry more today than ever in my life. It's just ridiculous. It's embarrassing sometimes, I gotta tell you, but the Lord makes our heart tender. Margie. When we truly love our Savior Jesus Christ and we sin against him, it truly breaks our hearts and we cry out to him. I never take it lightly when I do sin. I know I am saved by grace, but never want to think, oh, it's okay, I'm saved. It truly breaks my heart to think I would hurt my Savior. I get that, Margie, and I agree. I agree. When we sin, we're disappointed, you know. If you're celebrating your sin, you're kind of in trouble. That's different, you know. But he washed it all away. He washed us white as snow. In God's time, a false gospel looks to you and your works for salvation. A true gospel looks to Jesus Christ and his works on the cross for salvation. Choose wisely. I really like that. Thank you. So true. Choose wisely. We're in the last days. We are in the last days. I've been coming here 2 years telling you we're in the last days. And we're 2 years closer to the rapture. This is so important. What I'm going to tell you is so important. If you are on the fence and if you haven't taken a side yet, somebody said, many people said, Satan owns the fence, so get off the fence. You need, your time is running out to find out what Jesus did for you and put your belief and trust and hope in what he did for you. And I try to make it as simple as I can. I try every day to make it so simple and just tell you, we're all sinners. We all have done the wrong thing. We've thought the wrong thing. We all fall short of the glory of God. God expects perfection and we can't do that. But Jesus came. The Father sent him, his only begotten Son. And Jesus came to this world. He wrapped himself in human flesh and he was perfect. He fulfilled the law perfectly. He didn't fall short of the glory. He was perfect. And he paid for our sins with his blood. And that's how simple it is. You have a problem. I have a problem. We all have a problem. My problem's been rescued by the blood of Jesus and my belief in his finished work. And yours can be too. We're all sinners and we need payment for those sins or we're going to show up on judgment day. And we're going to be eternally separated from God if we reject the payment that was made for our sin, aka hell. And it's not easy to talk about hell. It really isn't. I don't like telling anyone, if you don't accept the payment for your sins, which was paid for by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords with his own blood, if you don't accept that payment, you're going to show up on judgment day with your sins still with you. And you're going to be sent away. The most terrifying moment of your life. And I don't want anyone to have, nor does God. Jesus doesn't want anyone to perish. That's why he paid such a serious price, being brutalized and nailed to a cross. The only begotten Son of God being nailed to a cross, the Lamb of God, the perfect sacrifice, being nailed to a cross to shed blood that is so powerful that if you say, yes, I am a sinner, I believe that blood has the power to wash me white as snow, to give me a clean slate. And that's exactly what the belief, the faith in that blood will do. It will wash away your sins forever, wash you white as snow. Not even God will remember your sins. Not even he, whoo, that was dramatic rain there. Not even God will remember your sins. That's what Jesus did for you. He wants to spend eternity with you and he's done all the work. You don't have to do anything but believe. It's a free gift. We're saved by grace an unearned gift through faith in what Jesus did for us. It's free. It's right in front of you. You say, Jesus, I am a sinner. And wow, you paid for my sins with your blood? You were tortured in my place? Because when we sin, we earn death. The wages of sin is death. But we're saved by grace, the unearned gift. Take it. Take it. Say to Jesus, thank you for shedding that blood. Yes, I want to be washed white as snow. Thank you for going to the cross and being placed in the tomb and rising on the third day. Thank you. I believe in that. When you do that, you're saved. You're rapture ready. You won't be left behind. And we're so close. Do it today. Today is a day of salvation. Don't put it off. Don't put it off. You may not have time.
It looks like you haven't set up any HomeKit accessories.
I'm sorry. That was me turning off my phone and somebody talking to me that's not a human. Oh, Lord, I can't wait until we're with Jesus and these phones are burning down here. I gotta tell you, I'm not a huge fan. We need the technology to do what we're doing here, but I am not a fan. Yeah, so choose wisely. Run to Jesus. If what I just said means anything to you, run to him and say, yes, Jesus, I believe in your blood. I believe in your finished work. Thank you. You'll be born again. You'll be sealed unto the day of redemption. You'll be rapture ready. It's going to happen at any time. We're waiting for it. We're waiting for it. And we keep getting the dramatic rain at the perfect time. But I'm going to shut the camera off now and I'm going to pray for every person who watched this video. And if we're not raptured today, and you guys, today is a perfectly good day for the rapture. But if not, God willing, I will see you guys tomorrow. I love you guys.